give the Lord another big hand clap. Amen. You may be seated this morning in the presence of the Lord. And this morning, right before we get started, I don't know if you noticed, there have been a lot of graduations happening for our young people. Can I hear an amen, somebody? Some of them just left the platform. Hello. But this morning, what we want to do, we want to acknowledge all the graduates and all the promotions. You graduated, or you got promoted. I want you to stand up if there's anybody in here that graduated or got promoted. Not from the men's home, not all right. There's a Elias graduated, my daughter Desiree graduated, and we just want to acknowledge that they took off. And I'm going to pray for them, and just go ahead and stand to our feet. Come on up here, young man, come here, I want to pray for you. Yeah. And I want all the graduates, I want Desiree and Alaya, and if there's anybody else that graduated, we want to just pray God's blessing on your life. Come on up, and where's Nico? Is Nico here? Come here, Nico. Don't be shy, brother. And if you know somebody that graduated or one of your kids, bring them up here. Anybody else? Taina, too. See, I got it right. Amen. And I want some people to come and help me pray. Come up close right this side here. And some of the women, come on, Lisa and Renee, come and help me pray. Amen. We're just going to pray a blessing on you guys that God will continue to further your education and God will begin to show you the steps that you need to take in life. Because God has a plan for each and one of you guys, man. He has an awesome plan. Believe me. And as you, education is good. Pursue your education, but also know the plan of God is better. I'm not saying don't go to school, so don't get me weird. Education is good. You got to have education, man, if you want to live good and stuff like that. The plan of God is always much better than education. Why don't we stretch our hands more? Heavenly Father, I pray your blessing upon these young people, Lord. I pray, God, that this in the season of their life, God, that you would continue to direct their steps. I pray, Father, that you would continue to give them guidance and direction, Lord, from their parents. God, use their parents, Lord. Lord, in the season of their life, Lord, that is very crucial, God, that they would make the right decisions, oh God, and seek advice, God, and counsel, Lord, that they can continue to pursue all that you have for them, Lord. I pray a blessing over their minds, over their hearts. I pray that the call that you have on each and one of these young people, God, would be stirred up, God, like never before, God. Lord, that love that you have for them, Lord, would just be evident in everything that they do, God. And I thank you for them. Bless them right now, God. Let them continue to pursue all that you have for them, my God. And let your blessing be upon them. Bless them for all their efforts and all their hard work, God, that they did to get this far, God. But continue to give them the strength that they need to go even further. We thank you and love you. And in Jesus' name, everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Congratulations, you guys. We're so proud of you guys, man. Congratulations. Amen. God is so good.
All the time.
Amen. They accomplished something I've never accomplished.
Amen.
And I know a lot of you didn't accomplish either. So don't look at me like that.
Come on.
Let me see the diploma. And as you remain standing, get your Bibles and go with me to Leviticus chapter 6. And we're going to be reading verse 12 and 13. I'm not going to be very long this morning, but I believe that we got to get the Word of God out. And it's the Word of God that is alive. It's the Word that works in our life. It's the Word of God that gives us life.
Amen.
Amen. And as you're doing that, a couple more announcements. Maybe you noticed that the grass was kind of brown when you came in. No, we didn't paint it. We're getting our grass redone. As a matter of fact, the gardener killed it. We sprayed the stuff on it. And it's dying because it had a lot of weeds in there. So I think this next week we're putting in new sprinklers. We're going to put a whole new top soil for the fresh soil. We're going to put new seed. This new seed that stays green and stays healthy in the winter and in the summer. I guess it's something new that they came out. My gardener told us about. So that's what they're doing, amen. We didn't neglect it. We didn't forget to water it. Don't be hard on Mikey. Mikey didn't forget. Don't be Mikey. You killed the grass. You killed her. The grass killer. You know, no, we're not trying to dry it out to smoke it or anything like that. I'm going to justify some things in our church because I know how our church is, amen. I'm not selling it and bagging it up. And I know that's what you're thinking. Oh, it's a fundraiser. It's a fundraiser. We're bettering the house of God. Can I hear you? And so we got that boy. We got an awesome gardener. They're Christians. They're people of God. They take care of us. Also, we're getting our men's home. All the pipes are being redone in our home because we had the old galvanized pipes. And now galvanized pipes, you know, there's all kinds of stuff that's in there, been in there for years. So we're redoing our piping. We got a new water here. We're just hooking up the men's home. And thank God we have Brother Joe. He's a contractor. His name is Joe Rodriguez. And you probably see this truck out there. And he's a member of our church. And he's blessed us, man. He's done so much more than we asked for, man. So much more than we expected. That's Joe over there. He's part of our balcony crew right there. And a good man. Loves God, man. He has an awesome business. And if you ever need any construction business, he does it all, man. He does the whole, he's licensed and insured and full of the Holy Ghost. Can I hear amen? That's what you want, so you can see him, and he's really good on his prices, amen?
Amen.
Amen. Enough for the commercials. Now let's get into the word. Leviticus chapter 6, verse 12. The Bible says, the fire on the altar must be kept burning. It must not go out. Every morning the priest is to add firewood and arrange the burnt offering on the fire and burn the fat of the fellowship offerings on it. Verse 13, the fire must be kept burning on the altar continuously. It must not go out. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for your presence that is in the house. I pray, God, that this morning that you would minister to the hearts and the minds of your people. I pray, God, that you would stir us up, that you would be our inspiration this morning, God. I pray that you would speak life, my God, into every heart and into every mind, God. Expose every lie of the enemy, God. Pull down every high thing that would try to exalt itself above the knowledge of your word, God. And let your word be first and foremost within our minds and in our hearts as we walk this journey that you have us in. I pray your blessing upon you. Give me the words to speak, God. Let your spirit inspire my heart, my mind right now, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. You may be seated this morning in the presence of the Lord. We've been talking about keeping your fire for God from the beginning of the month. We've been talking about getting back to the basics, getting on fire for Jesus again. Can I hear an amen, somebody? Because how many know there's too much wet wood in the church?
Amen.
There's too many people that are just laid back, that are just compromised, that are just taking it easy in the church. And it's not God's will that we be in that condition. And it's not God loves us. Yes, he loves us. But believe me, when you begin to understand what God has called us to, it begins to burn within your heart. Things begin to happen. And here we find in the book of Leviticus, we find the order of the, on the altar in the temple of the order of sacrifice. And it was talking about that there was an altar there, and on the altar there needed to be a fire. And it was the priest's responsibility to keep that fire burning for the sacrifices that were being presented in the temple. And it was that priest's job to keep that fire burning continuously, having the urgency and having the responsibility of not allowing it to go out. How many know that the Bible says down in the New Testament that we are the priests, that we are priests and kings in the house of God? Can I hear an amen, somebody? That we no longer have to go through somebody to get a hold of God. Back here, that the priest was the one that was the mediator between man and God. It was the priest's responsibility to lead the people to God and to present the offering, to bring a covering of forgiveness over Israel at that time. But the priest is not there anymore. We have access to the King of Glory. Can I hear an amen, somebody? We have access to the King of Kings. And the altar is not an altar. Though we have an altar in the house of God, and the altar is very powerful. An altar is a place where God alters the heart of people. But the altar is not only here, but the altar is an altar in our heart. We carry an altar because the Bible says that we are the temple of the Holy Ghost. So everything that was there in the physical temple that was represented in the Old Testament is now transferred onto the new temple. We are the temple of the Holy Ghost. And we need to have a fire burning on the temple, on the altar of our heart. There needs to be a fire burning, and we are the priests of our temple, as God has called us. That's why the Bible says in Romans 12:11, it says, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. In other words, there needs to be a fire burning within every man, woman, and child that has come to the understanding and the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And so what I want to talk about this morning, I want to get right into it, is I want to give you three steps that you could regain or you could restart a fire or passion for God that we have to possess within our life. Three steps. Very simple, very, you know, it's not complicated. You don't have to, you know, learn or get a dictionary to understand that. You don't have to go to a school. It's very simple. Number one, the first step that you got to take on keeping your fire for God or experiencing a greater increase in passion or love and fire for God is number one. Number one, you got to make up your mind that you're going to regain your fire for God. There's a lot of people in the church today that haven't made up their mind. They don't know if that's what they want. And what hides behind that decision is, I'm not ready for it. It's just you haven't made your mind up. You haven't, because whatever you fix your mind to, that's what direction your life will go. Because there's power in a made-up mind.
That's right.
See, before you came to the Lord, everything that consists of your life was things that had happened because you made your mind up to be that. You made your mind up to, you know, to just do whatever you wanted. Didn't care about things, and that's what you lived. So once you made a mind up, your mind up to, you know, to get involved in drugs or to get involved with, you know, whatever you got involved in, you had to make up your mind before you did it. When I was in the world, I made up my mind that I was going to be involved in a gang. And I made up a mind and I got involved in it. And I lived it out because I had a made up mind. And because of that, until my mind was changed, my life remained that way from the last decision I made.
Amen.
Many of us here this morning, you haven't made up your mind. You're still, you know, thinking, should I or shouldn't I? Should I go all the way? Because I know that everybody in this room, and you've been coming to this church, there's something being stirred up inside of you, man. God's telling you to get in the fire, get in the water. Man, the Spirit of God is stirring the house of God. There's a fresh stirring that is in this place this morning. There's a stirring of the Holy Ghost and of the fire of God that is coming through the worship and everything that is done. Man, it's being presented before the people. Now, you've got to make up your mind that that's what you want to do. A lot of times we can't make up our mind because we got our mind on other things.
Right.
You got your mind on your money and your money on your mind. Uh-huh. Listen, come give me a beat, Hannah. You got your mind on your money and your money on your mind. You know that song. It's whatever your mind is set. Whatever you set your mind to, there's power in a made-up mind. For many of us here this morning, you're as close as just making a decision. But because that decision is lacked, then it's so hard because you haven't made a decision. Because that's why you struggle, because you haven't made a decision. That's why you're in it sometimes and you're in it, you know, some of the other times you're not in it. And you go back and forth, back and forth. It reminds me of what James had said in chapter 1, verse 7. He says, for let not a man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. How do you know if you haven't made your mind up and getting on fire for God? You're unstable.
Come on.
There's no stability within your life. You're in one day. You're hot one day. You're cold the next day.
Come on.
You're on fire one day. You got your halo and you're buffing it out one day. And the next day your tail comes out. And then you want to... One day you're in church, the next day you're in the club. Well, one day you're on fire for God, the next day you're, you know, You're on fire for someone else. Hello, somebody. Fornicating all over the place.
Hello.
Oh my God, it got hot in this place. When you begin to understand that there's power in a made up mind. I like what it says in Daniel chapter 10, verse 12. This is when Daniel had prayed to the Lord for help, and it was prolonged because of the prince of Persia had held up his response. And the angel came in response to Daniel's prayer. But here in verse 12, he says, then he continued. This is the angel speaking to Daniel in response to the prayer that he had. He said, then he continued, do not be afraid, Daniel. Since the first day that you set your mind to gain understanding and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard, and I have come and respond to them. As soon as you make up your mind and humble yourself, God, the fire of God's going to drop on you like, man, it's going to just burn you up. Can I hear amen, somebody?
Yeah.
It's going to consume everything bad in you and bring forth everything that is good in you. As soon as the angel says, since the first day that you set your mind, the first day you set your mind, in other words, the first day that you made up your mind, that's what I'm going to do. It was years ago, my wife and I, when we came and there with Pastor Ruben in Buena Park with our pastor, we were there and we were looking for a church and we just wanted God, man. Our marriage was all messed up. We were getting ready for a divorce, man. We had WWE fights every Saturday night. Can I hear an amen, somebody?
Come on now.
You can't say nothing because you're there right now. I know that. and man, our marriage was all messed up. But I remember we went there and we went to the church and we rededicated our heart to God. And then we both decided, we made up our mind that we were going to serve the Lord. We made up our mind that that's the church that God wanted us to be planted in. And we've been there ever since. And we made up our mind. The power of a made up mind. See, when you make up your mind, then hell and hot water will come your way. Trials will hit you on every side. And you'll feel the flames of hell. But you won't change your mind because you made up your mind. And you remain focused on what God has for your life. You're not moved by your emotions. You're not moved by what people tell you. Or people say, see, many times people are able to influence your life because you haven't made up your mind. And people know, you should be doing this, and you should be doing that. And then you go doing this and doing that. And because you haven't settled within yourself, you haven't made up your mind. And if you're married, you haven't made up your mind in your marriage that we're going to serve the Lord. And because of that, there's no fire. There's no fire. You're just holding on. You're just going through the calisthenics of religion. You're just occupying space.
Come on.
Yes. You're just going through things and it's boring. And you come up and you're giving your service to God by showing up. But then after that, you're doing everything else that you're not supposed to be doing.
Reach it.
Because you haven't made up your mind.
Yeah.
It's a religious, it's something religion. It's a form of religion, but no power.
Yes.
There's no power because there's no change that follows. When you make up your mind, that's when you give God permission to begin to move in your life.
Yes.
I like what it says in Colossians chapter 3, verse 2. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things.
Amen.
You got to focus your mind. You got to set your mind. That's the first step. You got to make up your mind. I believe some of you here this morning, God's bringing you to a place of decision to make up your mind. You're there, you're straddling the fence. One foot in and one foot out. You want God, but you want this still. You want God, yes, but you're still not ready to uproot the other foot and put, okay, now we want God all the way. Now that I got your attention, you got to make up your mind. Turn to your neighbor and say, make up your mind. Now turn to the other neighbor and say, yeah, you too, make up your mind. So don't look at me like that. And then after you make up your mind, check it out. After you make up your mind, number two, then you got to get closer to the flame.
Come on.
We're talking about getting on fire. Once you make up your mind, that's going to set you in a direction. That's going to set you in a way that you need to go.
Amen.
God's going to show you. And then you got to get closer to the flame.
Yes.
if you want to be on fire. And we know where the fire comes from. The Bible says that Hebrews 12, 29, our God is a consuming fire.
Amen.
Our God is a consuming fire. The Bible says that we were baptized with the Holy Ghost and with fire.
Amen. That's right.
That when you get closer to God, then you got to start getting closer to God. You got to start moving in the direction that you're getting closer to God. And you got to do the things that God is revealing to you through His Word. And as we gather in the house of God, as God brings order to the house and gives direction for this part of the body of Christ, you got to get closer to the flame. Everybody wants to be on fire, but you're so far away from the flame. You might ask me, well, how do I get closer to the flame? How do I get closer to God? I'm glad you asked. Because in James chapter 4, verse 7 and 8, it tells you how to get closer to God. The Bible says, James 4, 7 and 8, it says, submit yourself. Oh, there's that word, submit. Oh, God, why did he have to say that? I'm turning off now. That's it. You lost me, Pastor. I do everything but submit. Because I'm free. Okay. James 4, 7, it says, submit yourself, therefore, to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Okay? Then verse 8 says, draw nigh to God. That word nigh means close. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Very simple. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Let's go back to the decision. Making a decision. And then in verse 10, he ends it there. He says, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up.
Amen.
How do we get closer to God? Number one, we got to submit. You got to submit to God. How do you get closer to the flame? You got to submit to God. You got to submit. Turn to your neighbor and say, submit.
Submit.
How did they look when he said that? They didn't even look you in the eye.
That's right.
Or you couldn't even look them in the eye. That's a heavy word. Some of you men are there trying to run your home and telling you, what, submit. Woman, you need to submit. But I'm going to tell the brother, you need to submit. Submit unto one to another. There needs to be submission. And when you look at that word submission, that means that you surrender. To submit means to surrender. You've surrendered. You've yielded yourself. Okay, God, I'm submitting to you, meaning I'm surrendering to you, God. I'm yielding to you.
Yes.
Willingly, I'm coming, and I'm yielding my life, everything that I am, my wife, my mind. Oh, where did that come from? My wife, too, yeah. You missed it, huh? I'm surrendering everything, God, everything that I am. When you learn how to submit, you're submitting to God's will for your life. How do we get closer to the flame? You got to submit. You can't get closer to God without submitting to Him. God wants us to submit to Him. And we need to surrender. We need to yield. Not yell. Some of you are yelling. Not no yell. Yield. You need to yield your life to God. What I mean by yielding is like you have a car and you're the driver and you drive. And the Lord wants to be a part of your life. He comes in your vehicle. And you think you're going to drive Him around. And you get right here. Okay, Lord, thank you for God. Man, I've been praying for you to come over. Sit down right there. Oh, God. Yeah, and you're driving your life. And God said, yield to me. Get out of the driver's seat. Let me get in the driver's seat.
Amen.
And yield to me. And let me show you where I can take you.
Amen.
But a lot of us want to take God for a ride. You got to submit. Then after that, after you submit, then James gives his other advice. He says, resist the devil. And he will flee from you. In other words, then you got to begin to change your ways. And the devil that he's talking about there is the devil and all the authority of the prince of this air and all the principalities and all the spiritual wickedness that is there, yeah? but also the devil in you.
Come on,
man.
Which is, what is our, the devil that's in us? Is our flesh. You got to resist the devil, and you got to resist your flesh.
Amen.
You got to submit and resist. You got to submit and resist. You got to submit to God, and then you got to resist all the cravings of your flesh that the enemy is trying to stir up. The devil knows you love, weed cookies. Hello, somebody. Somebody want a cookies? You'll get it later. But you got to learn to resist the devil. You got to resist everything that the enemy is trying to bring into your life. There's a lot, man, I see it happen a lot, and I know very easily I could be drawn into this. Is you could be drawn by your flesh or drawn by the enemy and to enjoy something that you know that is not of God. And then you want to be walking with the enemy all week and then come and, you know, and just come into the presence of God and say, God, you know, I want you to do whatever you want to do in my life today. You got to resist. You got to learn how to fight. You got to learn how to govern your life. You got to learn how to cause change as you, because as you really submit and as you really yield and you really surrender your life, resisting the enemy is kind of, it's easier. It's when you haven't submitted that resisting the devil is hard.
Amen, that's right.
There's a lot of people say, I can't resist the devil, it's just too hard, because you haven't first submitted to God. That's the order that it gives. It doesn't say, resist the devil, then submit to God. No, submit to God first, then resist the enemy. After you have submitted to God, then now you have the authority, you have the power to resist the devil. Now you have the authority within your life by the Holy Ghost to make changes within your life, to turn your life around, to set a new course within your life and say, I ain't going to do that no more. I ain't going to do that no more. This is what I'm going to do. This is what my family's going to do. This is the direction that we're headed. After you have submitted yourself to God, then you can resist the devil. Because the devil's slick, man. He's sly. He knows what you like.
That's right.
He knows what you like.
Right.
He knows what moves your flesh. And he uses your flesh to get you. How do we get closer to the flame, closer to God? Submit to the Lord. You got to resist the enemy. In other words, that's where the battle's at. That's where the battle's at. And then the third thing, then you got to draw nigh to God. Then you got to draw close to God. How do you draw close to God? You got to begin to pray. You got to have a prayer life. You want to get closer to the flame? Submit, resist, and start praying. You got to make time for God in prayer. You got to get in the presence of God. To a lot of us here this morning, that doesn't make sense. You know why that doesn't make sense? Because prayer is something done in the physical, but it moves the spiritual. Prayer is spiritually. You can't, you know, prayer is not a place you go and you check in and then there's somebody there that you tangibly can see. Okay, I hear you. Okay, thank you. You showed up today. Okay, this is my needs. These are my problems. Okay, you got that? Here's some more stuff. And you know, in case I don't forget to pray, if I forget to pray tomorrow, here's my prayer list for tomorrow. Take care of it. Okay, I'll see you later. Good to see you again. I'm God. Many of us, that's physical, thinking that's physical prayer. But prayer is spiritual. Prayer is separating yourself, going into your prayer closet or to a place all by yourself, and by faith, calling upon the Lord Jesus Christ, coming before his presence through the blood of Jesus, knowing that, yeah, that we're all sinners and we're saved by grace, but it's the blood that covers us. It's the blood that grants us access into the presence of God. And then we come into the presence of God and pour it on your heart before God. Pour it out your heart before God. Pour it out. Say, God, Lord, I'm struggling in these areas. God, I want to serve you and I want to do what's right. But man, I'm weak in these areas and I'm going to just present all my weaknesses to you, God. I need strength, God. Lord, these people are bugging me and they're just getting on my nerves, God. And I still have temptation to go out there and drink or go out there and get loaded, God. And go out there and sleep around, God. I have all these things going on. Lord, but I'm looking to you, God, for your strength, for your encouragement, for your word to stir me up, God, for your word to encourage me. Yes. before God. God hears your prayer. And he's moved by your prayer.
Amen.
It's not a religious prayer going before, but you know, you don't have to pray in King James. Oh, great and mighty, thus far God, I am thy servant that they have placed here on Chino Hills. It is I. I present myself before you, Lord. Smite not thee me, Lord. People think, I talk to people, I don't know how to pray. And what did you, and I tell them, what did you just say? I said, I don't know how to pray. I said, how could you say you don't know how to pray when you're praying right now, you're communicating. Prayer is communication.
Amen.
If you know how to talk, you know how to pray.
Amen.
If you don't know how to talk, then, you know, you got an excuse. Turn to your neighbor and say, hello. If they respond back and they talk, they can pray. Prayer is just communication with God. It's talking. That's a command. That's the way I talk to the Lord. I talk to God just, I say, God, you got to help me. I don't know what I'm doing. Lord, I feel like, man, I can't go on. Like, what's going on? I'm feeling this and I'm feeling that and this is coming against me. God, what's going on? I'm doing what you called me to do, God. You got to keep me. Don't let me get weird, God. Don't let me look back. And Lord, I want to have my eyes fixed on you, God. You got to strengthen me because I'm feeling weak right now. That's a lot of time my prayers like that. God, you got to help me. You got to strengthen me. I need you to strengthen me. And God hears my prayer because I'm still here. Because I poured out my heart before God.
Amen.
You got to begin to draw nigh unto God. How do you draw nigh unto God? By prayer. And by the word of God. The word of God is God. You want to draw nigh to God, you got to get to know who God is. You got to get into his word. And then you got to separate yourself. You got to begin to fast.
Amen.
Fast. I think we're going to do some more fasting in the church.
Amen.
And people are like, well, you know, we fast all the time, man. We eat real fast. Hey, let's fast today. Everybody ready? Okay, fast. But I think the times are changing a little bit. You know what? We're going to probably get a fast for the beginning of next month.
Amen.
And this fast is going to be a Daniel fast and a social media fast. Dude, I got almost all of you today. Oh my God, I can do it. Yeah, you're going to get your phone, turn it off, your computer, turn it off, and fast for God.
Praise God.
Fasting means to give something up. We're going to do that next month. We're going to do a week-long fast. And then we'll designate one person to check all the social media to make sure we get it out.
Come on.
And they'll be like, and that'll be me. We'll designate somebody that is not in this church. Ah, got you on. Everybody's going, me, Jesus. Can you imagine that? That's going to be a fast. If I know most of you, that's going to be a fast. No social media for a whole week. No Instagram. No Telegram. No Facebook. No FaceTime. No Snapchat. Come on, youth.
MySpace.
Oh, you're old, really? MySpace. You still trying to get your space? No Twitter, no tweeting on Twitter. All this stuff, you guys know what I'm talking about. We're going to get away from all that stuff. And we're going to draw close to God. Get ready for next month. And then we're going to have a week revival of prayer. A week-long revival of prayer. Amen. I believe that's going to set things up. We got to draw nigh unto God. You want to be on fire for God? You got to get closer to the flame.
Amen.
And who's the flame? It's Jesus Christ, man. And then the last thing, I'm going to have my wife come on up. I'm going to bring this so close. You got to make up your mind. Then you got to get closer to the flame. And the last thing you got to do is you got to take action. In other words, you got to do it. You got to make a decision, draw closer to God, and take action. I like what it says in 1 Peter 1:13. The Bible says, therefore, prepare your minds for action. Keep a clear head and set your hope completely on the grace that has been given to you when Jesus the Messiah is revealed. Then you got to take action. See, what happens when the people of God take action? God is waiting for a response. God is waiting for a response. Somebody to rise up and take action.
Amen.
It moves the heart of God. It reminds me of 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. When the Lord God wanted to revive the people of God, the people of Israel. Well, God was waiting for somebody to take action. And he said, if. That means it's not on God, it's on you, it's on me. If we take action. God says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. Now, I don't know about you, but this scripture always brings forth a stirring of revival. The people being revived. Healing needs to be made whole. And healing needs to be, the hand of God is moving and meeting every need. And the people of God are blessed and moving forward and in favor. God's waiting for his people. And I believe the Spirit of the Lord is saying this morning, if Chino Hills, if Living Word of Chino Hills, and all of us that are here this morning, if us, his people, who are called by our name, will humble themselves and pray and seek the face of God and turn from their wicked ways, then God will hear from heaven and forgive their sin and will heal their land. I believe it will move the hand of God. If you begin to take action, you say, yeah, today I'm going to make a decision within my heart. I'm going to make a fresh decision that I want God, that I want what he has for my life. I want what he has for my marriage. I want what he has for my children. I want what he has for my household. I want what he has for my family. Uncompromising, unwavering. I want what God has for my life. I'm going to stop half-stepping. I'm going to stop straddling the fence. I'm going to be all the way in. I'm not going to be cold. I'm not going to be lukewarm. But I'm going to be hot for God. I want to be on fire for God. And when you take action, taking action is responding. Responding, not only hearing, not only seeing and believing, but responding. Engaging your life in what God has for your life. Then and only then, you'll begin to see things change within your life. You'll see things begin to get right, and things to get in order within your life. And I'm not just talking just to talk or just to make it sound. I'm not trying to sell God. I'm not trying to sell the fire of God. I'm not trying to sell a better life. I'm not here. I'm just a messenger of the one who sent me. His name is Jesus Christ. And that God has an awesome plan for everybody in this house. But it's up to us whether we're going to obtain it or not. Don't think that I'm trying to sell you or trying to convince you. I'm not. Because I've got mine. I'm doing what God called me to do. I was one of those if my people. Yes, I am one. Okay, I'm going to act upon it. I'm taking action, God. I'm included in there. I'm your people. And wait, I got something here for me. Okay, include me, God. I'm in it. I'm in it. Are you in it this morning? Are you in it this morning? You better be in it. To get closer to God, to get closer to the flame, you got to take action, man. No more talking. Only those that want it. If you don't want it, that's fine. That's fine. I'm not going to try to preach you to it. I'm not going to preach you I turned blue to try to convince you. Because you know what? That's not my job. But if you don't want it, you don't want it. You don't have to have it. Is God grieved? Because he loves you so much and he has so much for you, man, that will blow your mind. If you would only make that decision and start to take action and start to appreciate your life and just make new decisions in your life to get your life in order to what God has, then you're going to see the blessing of God. But if you don't want it, if you love your life, then you'll lose the one that God has for you. That's what the Bible says. You got to lose your life to find it. And if you hold on to your life, you're going to lose the very one that God had intended for you. And I know a lot of people that went down that road. And you find out that when they get a little older, the finding goes on, the light goes on. Man, I should have did that. I should have made them changes a long time ago. I should have made them choices. I made bad choices. I yield to God. I didn't surrender to God. And because of that, now I'm here, I'm older, and now they live in regret. God loves them? Yeah, God loves them. They're going to go to heaven probably if they have Jesus in their heart. But they're not going to live life to the fullest life that God had for them here on earth. I want what God has for me. I know I'm going to get what God has for me in heaven. But I'm talking about God has something for you now. Now, right now. But you need to surrender. You need to make a decision. Okay, God, I want you. And you need to take it seriously. You need to be serious with Him. Don't play with God. Anything I know, man, I'm not playing with God. If I start getting weird, start acting stupid, I'm not going to come up here and play the game, play the part. You won't see me no more. If I start, I'm not going to live a double life.
Amen.
I'm going to live for God, I'm going to live for God.
Amen.
But thank God, thus far, I'm living for God. God gave me the grace. Because my heart is there. My heart is fixed. Am I perfect? No, I'm not perfect. I'm far from perfection. But one thing I do know, man, I need Jesus in my life, man. And without Him, my life would fall apart. Without Him, I wouldn't be who I am today.
That's right.
Without Him, my marriage will fall apart. My children would be... I'll destroy my children. I'll destroy the future of my kids.
Right.
I know that. And when I go through my struggles, I go through struggles just like you. As a matter of fact, get your struggles and time them about 100 times. That's my struggles. And all the things that come my way. But it's not about me. That's how I'm able to die to myself. It's not about me. God, it's about you. I don't care. I'm going to stand. I'm going to stand for you, Lord. I'm going to stand for my marriage. I'm going to stand for my kids. And I'm going to stand for the church. I don't care about what beat up sometimes. Spiritually, demons come in and visit me at night. Tell me he's going to kill me. Try to suffocate me. It doesn't stop me. Yeah, when I go through it all, man, I feel it and it's real. But I get up in the morning and say, I got another day. I got to do what God's called me to do. That's not going to stop me. I'm not going to stop because of that. Yeah, people will talk about us. People will, man, they talk good about it. But so what? They're promoting our church. Can I hear an amen, somebody? Yeah, talk about me. I'll give you more stuff to talk about, and you just stay around a little longer. That way you get the good stuff and make it some juicy stuff. But as you go and spread all that stuff, God will turn it around what was intended for harm and bring it for the good. And people are going to come to church because of you talking about me. And they're going to say, I got to go see this guy. They're going to come over here. The Holy Ghost is going to hit him. They're going to get saved by the power of God. They're going to fall to the ground. They're going to know that God is real. It already happened. It has happened a lot. So I don't care they talk about me. I'm not doing it for them.
That's right.
I'm doing it for God.
Yeah.
I don't care what people say. I don't care if people, you know, look at me weird and people, you know, are mean to me or, you know, just don't be mean to my wife. Hello, somebody. Don't be mean to my kids. You know, God keeps me on that one because, you know, sometimes the old man comes up, hello, somebody. It doesn't matter. It's not about us. It's about God, man. It's not about us. So nothing's going to stop me. That needs to be your attitude. Don't get moved by your emotions, by every little trial. Every little trial comes, oh, I don't want to serve God. Why are you getting mad at God? It's not God's fault. Right away, the first one you want to get mad at when things happen is God. When things go wrong in your family, when things go wrong in your life, I'm not going to church. I'm not going to serve. God didn't do you nothing. That was just a result of your decisions that you made and your choices. Why you got to get an attitude with God? You get mad at God. Don't let nothing stop you. Nothing. No emotion. No feeling. Don't let no man stop you. No woman.
Right.
Don't let your kids stop you from serving God. From being on fire. For my kids don't stop me. Just make a decision. I want to serve God. Make a decision and stick to it. You'll see that your life will begin to take shape, and then you'll begin to see God make something out of nothing. Because really what we have is just nothing. But in your eyes you think it's so much, but it's nothing. I say it's nothing because compared to what God has, now that's something.
That's right.
What God has, it has some weight, and it has purpose, it has meaning. As we all stand to our feet this morning, and I'm just speaking as your pastor, I'm just speaking from my heart. Because our heart, my wife and I, our heart is then just... It's to see you get what God has for your life. To see you move forward. To see you blessed, man. To see your families together. To see God blessing you, man. That's our reward. To see God blessing you. To see you doing good, man. To see you on fire for God. To see, you know, God moving in your life. To see God doing miracles in your life. To see God restoring and healing. To see God moving on your behalf. Opening doors that no man can shut. And shutting doors for you. And leading you, man. That's our blessing. That's all we want to see. And that's why sometimes I preach the way I preach. Because I have a passion to see you get what God has for you. But you've got to have that passion for it. I can just stir it up, but I can't do it for you.
Right.
You have to get it stirred up. You have to have that passion for God to see it happen in your life. Amen? It all begins with making a decision. As the worship team makes their way forward, as every head is bowed in the presence of the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for your word. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would begin to move upon the hearts of your people. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you begin to bring things to light in us, God, that may be holding us back. Spirit of truth, begin to expose every lie inside of us. Bring truth into us. Oh, God, have your way this morning in our hearts and in our lives. In our hearts and in our lives. And if you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, or maybe you served the Lord at one time, but you know you're not fully surrendered to God and you're not serving the Lord the way you should, well, today is your day. I want to pray for you. And if you're here today and you say, man, I need to give my heart to Jesus, and you want us to pray with you, and you want to accept Jesus into your heart to get a fresh start, whether it be for the first time. And if you're here this morning, I want to pray with you. And I just want you to just raise up your hand if there's anybody in this place that you want to give your heart to Jesus for the first time. God bless you back there. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? God bless you. God bless you. Those two hands over here. Anybody else? Just raise up your hand. If that's you this morning. If that's you this morning. Hallelujah. Anybody else? I want those that raise your hand. I want you to come. I want to pray with you. Come on up here. I want to pray with you from the back over there. Come on up here right here. From the back. We're just going to pray with you. It's okay. There's anybody else? And you say, that's me, man. I need Jesus. I need a new start. I'm not living right. Maybe you've been coming to church and you know you're not living right. Well, don't leave this place without rededicating your heart to God. If you're here this morning, that's you. I want you to come up. I want you to come up. We're going to say a prayer. We're going to say a prayer. When we say this prayer, just mean it with your heart. Say, Lord Jesus, I ask right now that you forgive me of all my sins. Say, come into my heart. Say, fill me with your spirit and give me life. Say, today I make a decision to live for you. Say, thank you, Lord, for giving me another chance in life. Father, I thank you this morning, and I pray your blessing upon these that are here at this altar. I pray, God, that you would begin something new within them, Lord. Let there be a fresh start, God, within their hearts. Let there be a fresh start, God. Oh, Ramashika Tabianda Rabakato Morika. Oh, Ramadianda. Bless them right now, Father. Bless them right now. Bless them right now. Bless them right now. Bless them right now. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen. As we get ready to sing that song, and this is for the church. Maybe you're here this morning, and maybe you're struggling, and you haven't made your mind up, and you're basing everything on your feelings, and your feelings is going to confuse you, man. You got to make up your mind up within your spirit, within your heart. Maybe you're there, and then, you know, you're just going back and forth, and you're not really gaining any ground. You're not moving anywhere. But yet you have a desire to get closer to God. Some of you need to take a step this morning to get closer to the flame, man. You need to take action this morning. And action is taken here at the altar as you respond to the call of God.
For more information about our church, visit our website at lwchfoursquare.com. Also like our Facebook page at Living Word of Chino Hills. And follow us on Instagram at lwch. We hope that you enjoyed this video. Thank you and God bless. Breathing in the breath of heaven.